The Dave Carter Show is part of the Ricochet Audio Network run by Ricochet.com. Here's why you should join the Ricochet community. You can write your own post or comment on thousands of other posts on every conceivable topic. Connect with conservatives from across the country and around the world. Ricochet is the home of smart and civil conversation on the web. Join or create your own Ricochet group and interact with others who have the same hobbies, interests, and pursuits. Check it out at ricochet.com/join. Membership starts at just $4.50 a month, and you'll be supporting podcasts like this one. Go to ricochet.com/join right now and join the conversation.
Storyteller, historian, hellraiser. It's Dave Carter, and this is the Dave Carter Show.
Well, I guess you could say we're getting things fired up today, and we're going to focus to a large extent on my home stomping grounds in Louisiana, from Pat Darbonne, who's a Cajun cook, dear friend who's making a name for herself nationally, to General Hatchet. My friend Joel Valdez is here in studio to join in the services. I'm Dave Carter. I'm a retired military veteran with 3 tours of duty in the Middle East, a year spent in lovely Korea, and some deployments all over the place. I'm a former private detective, a radio show host, and once I hung up the nation's uniform, I spent about 15 years driving 18-wheelers all over the country. But lately, I while away my days toiling in the men's department at a very nice department store, which is where I met the brilliant young gentleman seated in the studio with me. Up until recently, Joel Valdez worked in the watch department at the aforementioned department store, but he has since left the building, and he took his Michael Jackson music with him, we hope. Though, correct me if I'm wrong, but I heard you playing Christmas music in there recently, right?
Guilty.
what were you on at that day? I'm just wondering if you might be willing to share that in the future. Certain kind of glue or...
I can't tell you.
Okay. How you doing, by the way?
I'm well. How are you today?
I'm good. Thanks for being here, by the way, and taking the time yet again to appear on the show. I appreciate it.
Out of my busy schedule.
Yes, I know. Because now that you're not doing the department store thing anymore, even. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I think you and the listeners are going to enjoy the proceedings here today. There's a delightful lady that I actually went to school with, and I assume she's paid more attention to her studies than I did, because she's really excelling following her passion and her talents. She's just killing it. Her skills as a Cajun and Creole cook have garnered national attention, and she will soon be on national television showing everyone how it's done back home on the bayou. She'll be joining us today on this program to tell us a bit about how it's done as well. Pat Darbonne will be coming up, and so will General Hatchet, who will regale us with God knows what. And, of course, the usual mischief and trouble will ensue, as always. Now, Joel, when it comes time to depart in any given job or situation, we all have our reasons, and I won't ask you to dwell on those, except to say, number one, you will be missed.
Thank you.
By a lot of really good people. And number two, you are presumably moving on to something really cool, and opportunities loom on the horizon, I hope. Is that right?
Yes, here's hoping.
Yeah, okay. So what kind of prospects are you looking at? Anything you can talk about on the future?
Yes. Currently, I am in talks for employment at a water systems management company.
Oh.
Yeah, so they deal with the water systems in different corporations, whether it be hotels, hospitals, and they try to prevent waterborne diseases from spreading.
Okay. Well, do you know what role you'll be playing in that? Or
I would be the account manager, so I would keep up with different clients and go to the sites and, you know, see what's going on throughout the day.
Okay. All right. So ultimately, well, you're homing in on the whole engineering degree, right? How close are you to finishing that up?
2 more months.
I'm sorry?
2 more months.
Wow. Okay. So whenever you're done, are you looking to stay in the Memphis area? Are you looking to get out of the Memphis area? Or are you just going to follow where you want to go, regardless of where that is?
I'll go wherever. It doesn't matter to me. I would like to stay in Memphis, but if something is calling me in Detroit, so be it.
You know.
Yeah.
That's an interesting time.
Maybe not Detroit.
Yeah,
maybe,
I've been through there.
If it calls, I won't answer. Yeah.
It's not what it used to be. Well, back to the old department store for a moment. Like I said, everyone has their reasons, but I've also heard, And I've noticed it myself in the last year that I've been back in retail work, that after a while, your faith in your fellow man kind of takes a bit of a hit.
It does.
That's been your experience, or do you remain hopeful for what Mark Twain called the damned human race?
I think that now that I'm out, I'll get that hope back.
Yeah.
It's a little low right now.
Recently, you and I both had the opportunity to straighten up the ladies' shoe department.
Oh, that was so much fun.
Yeah, I know. Where the ladies wrecked the place multiple times. The term of art that they use is to recover the place. It's actually a reconstruction project.
Yeah.
But shoes were literally thrown all over. I mean, dozens of them. And then you'd see just one shoe over here.
Yeah.
You know, and the other one is not to be found. I called them widows and orphans. And they were all over. They stick them back on the stand. They throw them on the ground. Empty shoe boxes.
Hide them under chairs.
Yeah. One shoe.
Mm-hmm.
I don't quite get it. They're like a cattle stampede went through there. And then the same thing in the men's department, where I am now, having left the watch department. And you go into the fitting rooms, the dressing rooms, and it looks like a bomb went off.
Oh, yeah.
Take things off of the rack and throw them. You know, just it's unbelievable. What do you attribute that kind of behavior to? I mean, is it the anonymity of a crowd and no one knows me anyway, so I'll do what I want to do, or is it something else at work?
I think a lot of people have the mentality of it's someone else's job to pick it up, not mine. I'm buying something, so I'm going to do what I please.
I used to say when I was driving an 18-wheeler that if you want to see what a person is really like, give them the anonymity of a car with tinted windows and watch what they do on the highway. Mm-hmm. Watch how they cut people off or various other things. And you'll see they will do behavior. They will act in ways in traffic when no one knows them that they would never dream of doing if they were in a bank, for example, or something like that. It's the weirdest thing. Perfect juxtaposition, by the way, of Shoppers in Trouble happened a few weeks ago. You weren't there.
No,
but we actually had an active shooter situation at the mall, not in the store, but at the mall itself.
Mm-hmm.
And I was in the back in the men's department, ringing up markdown items for people. They were buying them by the pile, and I noticed folks running toward the exit.
Mm-hmm.
And I heard someone say, "There's a shooter." My ears kind of perked up. I looked around, and I actually saw managers pointing everybody out.
Yeah.
So I told everyone, put your merchandise down. There's a couple of people I actually had to say, no, put the stuff down. We've got to leave now. They weren't all sure what was going on, but something was happening. They closed the access to the mall from the store.
Yeah.
And I stood at the door for a while, motioning people, and kind of went into military mode.
Oh, yeah.
Commanding them, get out now.
Yeah.
And they got out. It was just a couple of weeks ago, you know. But it wasn't a traumatic thing, and it turned out afterwards that the shooter or shooters are kids, I believe. Like a 16-year-old kid was involved, and it was actually happening outside.
Of the Macy's. And,
yeah, or Cheesecake Fresh, somewhere around there.
Some on the other side of the mall.
Right, but it was in close proximity, close enough to where people inside thought it was happening inside. You get the concussion and the sound of gunfire. It's not like it is on TV or the movies. It's really loud.
Oh, yeah.
So you hear it, you think it's wherever.
Mm-hmm.
And you can get a traumatic event. You can have two people see the same event, and they'll come up with three or four different versions of what happened just between the two of them.
Oh, yeah.
So you get what they call the fog of war. It's just an initial chaos, and nobody knows what's going on. So you go on the best information that you think you have at the time. So they got rid of us. And then they let a few people back in, and then eventually the police were just combing the entire area, clearing the area, and they sent everybody home. I it's just a strange thing, but you weren't there, right?
No, I didn't get to play, I guess. I didn't get to see what happened.
Does that kind of jive with what other folks are telling you that happened?
Yeah, but what I heard from a lot of people was that, you know, even though we get training on what to do during those situations,
right,
they didn't follow it. So I was told.
Yeah, there was no alarm, whatever.
That when it happened, people were. I mean, because they give us the 3-step program.
Right.
Run. Right. First, hide if you can, and fight if you have to.
Fight if you need to. Yeah.
Yeah, but everyone was hiding, rather than running.
Yeah, yeah. The silver lining and all that was that no one was hurt.
That is the silver lining.
You know, that's not more than a silver lining. I guess that's just amazing. It's great. But I have to admit, though, my already healthy dose of cynicism sort of amplified, if you can imagine that.
I can.
I try not to let that affect my initial reaction or interaction with people. Everyone deserves a smile. Everyone deserves a joke, in my case, and a reason to laugh. And I treat people with dignity until they show otherwise. Going forward, do you think that your time in this line of work will make you more or less tolerant of people generally?
Definitely more.
Yeah?
Definitely more. I think that what I've gained from working in retail I can use anywhere in the world. I think I'll definitely be able to. No matter who I meet, I think I've met a modicum of them in someone else.
Yeah. Well, something we were talking about before we started recording tonight, when Shelley and I and you were out to dinner, and she mentioned that there's so many different cultures mm-hmm. that you come into contact in the world of retail that you wouldn't otherwise deal with in the normal course of your day. And it really is an eye-opener, and in some ways it's fantastic.
It is.
And you learn a lot about other people and different cultures and different approaches to life.
Yeah, and even when you don't have those fantastic experiences, you still learn something about how to deal with an individual who might have certain qualities that don't really mesh well with yours.
And you learn a little bit about yourself, too.
Yes. You learn your limits.
What you ought to learn, some of us better than others, I think you excel at it, is when to rein back.
Oh, yeah.
The impulse to say, get out.
Oh, yeah.
You know, enough. Yeah, understand. We are talking with my friend, Joel Valdez, and we'll have Pat Darbonne coming up here in a little while, and a whole bunch of other craziness straight ahead. All right, here now with whatever happens to be on his mind at any given moment is the Dave Carter Program Senior Current Affairs Analyst, General James R. Hatchett, Jr., the third.
The greatest groin hits. Fool.
Wait a minute. What is this?
It's one of my favorite clips from the funny video show where a guy takes a cue ball right to the old mailbox, if you get my drift.
But why do we have to... I mean, first of all, it's a video clip and this is an audio program, so I don't understand...
Trust me. You'll know what's happening. Besides, you said I could talk about whatever happens to be on my mind at any given moment.
I know I did. I just thought maybe your mind was a bit more elevated.
Oh, here comes the good part.
Fine. Well, that's just great. Now we're reduced to reveling in the agony of a guy who gets a cue ball to the...
To the cue balls. Go ahead and say it. To the cue balls.
Fine. But what's the point of all this?
Don't you ever wonder what happened to the poor guy?
No.
You can't even pretend.
Okay. Why? Did you talk to him or something?
He recently came out of hiding and physical therapy, and our microphones caught the moment.
Look it. I don't understand what the big deal is all about. So I took a shot to the nads. So freaking what? Jeez Louise. It's not like I don't have a productive life.
No, you don't have a reproductive life.
So what line of work are you in now?
Politics.
What kind of political work are you in?
Political advisor to Mitt Romney. So what, man? Buzz off. That's all. I'm out of here.
Well, that explains a few things. But how does a guy with no balls and three strikes advise a politician who suffers from premature capitulation?
I think you're thinking too deep.
Well, one of us needs to.
Besides, I wouldn't make light of someone with missing body parts if I had undergone a hair evaporation process like you.
Oh, is that what we're going to do now, General? Is that what we're reduced to taking pot shots at the host?
Because just look at you.
I look fine. I've been told that I look like a distinguished gentleman.
You look like a dead chia pet.
Oh, man, that is funny, yeah.
You keep out of this, Alphonse.
We interrupt this program for a quick sports update.
Sports?
That's right. That's because good triumphed over evil last Saturday night as them LSU Tigers pounded the spit out of the Florida Gators.
I don't think we need to frame this as a contest of good versus evil here. I mean, it's just a football game, and these are two very, very good teams.
It's not just a game, Comdome. It's our way of life against theirs.
Well, I mean, you know, when you put it that way.
And once again, LSU submerged victorious. The Tigers would have scored even more points, but the game ended.
Who did we play this week, do you know?
Mississippi State, I think.
And they're known as...
Losers.
No, I mean their mascot. Who's their mascot?
I think it's a cowbell. Or maybe it's a dumbbell. It's hard to tell the difference.
Oh, gee, that's intimidating.
Yeah, they're a bunch of cute little...
That'll do.
In other news...
Hey, you know what we haven't done in a while?
What's that?
That's the Memphis Area Weather Report.
That's because your stupid show is heard outside of Memphis as well, genius.
I know that, but the weather here is so wildly off the charts, it's just kind of noteworthy. I mean, I spent a great deal of money on our back patio here at the house, by the way. Expanded the patio, put in a gorgeous gazebo, cemented the thing into the ground so it won't fly off like Mary Poppins when the wind cranks up. Got some lights in the gazebo that are they're controlled by Alexa. So all I have to say is, Alexa, turn on the gazebo.
Okay.
You know, and it works.
Oh, that's just wonderful.
Then we got some good furniture. Put a fire pit out there with turquoise colored broken glass in the thing, so it looks really nice. And got some nice speakers.
And your point is?
Well, my point is that we can only use a thing for about 2.5 weeks out of the year. I mean, spring lasts 2 weeks, tops. And then the temperature immediately goes to 197 degrees outside. And then fall lasts about 20 minutes before the bottom falls out of the thermometer and the rain and the ice and the snow starts and it's just hideous.
Then there are the stray bullets.
Nah, it's not that bad. I mean, anyway, Memphis area weather is as follows. Currently, it's 65 degrees, partly cloudy and continued cloudy till the sun comes out. And
why don't you open the door and see the weather for yourself?
That's a good idea. Now, as I was saying...
What's that?
That's the birds chirping.
Heavily armed birds.
The forecast for tonight calls for clear skies, except for some residual smoke and the occasional smell of gunpowder. There'll be an increased chance of inclement weather tomorrow as it rains cats and dogs and 9mm rounds and .40 caliber rounds. Residents are advised to keep their windows up, dress warmly in layers, and don't forget your umbrella and black vest. And that's your Memphis area weather forecast from the birthplace of the blues, Memphis barbecue, and more degenerates per capita than Chicago ever thought about having.
Have mercy.
And for the Dave Carter program, I am General James R. Hatcher, Jr.
Jr. the third. Yes, we know.
That is all.
All right, Alphonse, you just read the copy in front of you, and we'll be done, okay?
Me, I thought this was the original. It's a copy?
No, it's just a term of art. There's no need
to... Oh, come on. I don't see any art. There ain't no picture here.
Okay, so here we go in 3, 2, 1.
So you count backwards, huh?
No, just read the thing, please.
It's a Dave Carter show hosted by,
No.
By all means...
No. Don't ad-lib. I mean, just read the thing in 3, 2, 1. Three, two, one.
It's just a... You know that?
3, 2, 1.
It's a Dave Carter show on Ricochet.com. There, you happy, you old buzzard?
It's Alphonse Fontenot. Hey, when I was trucking about 15 years ago, I was going through Louisiana, and I heard a song on KBON. They call themselves K-Bone Radio. By the Lafayette Bayou Boys, called You Ain't Nothing But a Couillon, which is a crazy person.
Couillon.
Couillon. Here we go. Hey!
You ain't nothing but a couillon. You ain't never got no shoes on. You walk around saying, God, they don't. Man, you ain't nothing but a couillon. Ever since you was a little bitty boy, don't nobody want to let you play with the toys. When all the little girls, they would come around, you get in trouble trying to put their consoles down. You ain't nothing but a couillon. You ain't never got no shoes on. You walk around saying, God, they don't. And you ain't nothing but a couillon.
Dave Carter on Ricochet.com.
All right, we're here with my friend Joel Valdez. Coming up just a little bit, we'll have my friend Pat Darbonne on, a tremendously gifted Cajun cook who's making a national name for herself. Joel, are you keeping up with the Democratic presidential race?
I saw a little bit about it, yeah.
What do you make of it so far? How's that for a general question? Speaking of general things.
Just like with all the... every time around... You know, this early in it, you never really can tell.
Yeah.
I feel like the top players, maybe like Warren, other people like that, but there's no way to know.
What I've seen, this is just my, you know, my take on it, but from what I've seen, they're wanting to dismantle much of what makes for a booming economy, while simultaneously making plans to spend a colossal amount of money on freebies, which money they will get by taxing people who won't be making money because of the proposed wealth killing policies of these people are advocating. Of course, they want more money to make all this work. Does that make perfect sense to you, too?
I'm sure there's a book somewhere that says that's okay. Very special.
Karl
library.
Marx wrote it, I think. Yeah. Which is one reason why, honestly, I've kind of stepped back because for 35 years or more, I've followed current events and politics meticulously. And what I see over time, I forget who was that said this, but that history doesn't necessarily repeat itself, but oftentimes it rhymes.
Yeah.
So things kind of go in cycles, right? So we have a cycle where people have had enough of government interference and taking their tax money that they work hard for and giving it to other people. And so they throw those people out, and they bring people in who are pro-growth, pro-individual rights. And the result is it yields huge dividends. Unemployment goes down. What am I hearing?
A plane?
Not that a plane?
Yeah.
That's good microphones. Anyway, that's the economy taking off. That's what it is. But as things get
better. They took your advice.
Thank you. It's free. But as things improve, people become complacent.
Mm-hmm.
And invariably, they begin to be seduced by the siren call of wealth distribution.
Oh, yeah.
And things of that nature. And so they give into that, and then things go down. Unemployment goes up. The economy stagnates. Jimmy Carter, Barack Obama, to a large extent.
Yeah.
Everything's just grinds almost to a halt. And they say, this isn't good. And so they bring somebody in that changes it, and the cycle repeats itself.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
It may be part of age that I'm thinking, I've seen this.
Yeah, I mean, even I'm just 23, but even I've seen it, you know. They repeat the things of the past, but they say, oh, but I'm different. I'm not the same.
Yeah, yeah. What the other saying is,
I'm not Mussolini.
People who don't study history are condemned to repeat it, and the people who do are condemned to suffer while the other people repeat it.
Yeah.
So, anyway... you don't have notes. So you see the various notes I have on this page, right? Which yields inevitably to this page. A blank piece of paper popped out of the printer. So, I don't know. So what kind of headlines are you following right now?
Recently have been about the NBA stuff. That's what I've been looking into a little bit.
LeBron James saying we all really,
and the Rockets.
Yeah.
Yeah. Did you see anything about the Rockets?
I don't follow what team said what. I just see different personalities are saying we really ought not be taking up for the demonstrators in Hong Kong.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
We ought to sympathize and side with the Chinese.
That's the consensus among the NBA.
Yeah,
it seems like at least.
I think LeBron James tweeted a couple of days ago that he's really having a tough time right now, suffering on however many millions of dollars he makes, you know, while the people in Hong Kong just want to have the freedom to make an ass of themselves as well as he does.
Oh, yeah.
And they're protesting for that right, and apparently he's not too sympathetic to them.
Yeah, and it crosses over into more than just the NBA. It's the gaming industry as well.
The what?
The gaming industry.
Oh, really?
Competitive video games.
I wasn't aware of that.
Yeah, there was a competition, and someone had... they had spoken about it on a stream, so it was live, like, you know, that's television.
Mm-hmm.
And they withheld his prize money, and they told him he couldn't compete for like a year. And the casters who were narrating it, they got fired.
Oh my gosh!
For not saying anything. Yeah.
See, that makes my blood pressure start to go up. Same. Which is another one of the reasons why I've backed away from some of this stuff, because just. It's kind of like you try to fight it.
It's right? you don't think censorship like that is going to happen again, but it does.
It happens in increments.
Yeah.
Until one day, you know,
it's too late. Yeah.
It's too late. Well, it's a strange, strange world, right? Which means that sometimes it's a good idea to just sit back and relax, which is what I think we'll do at this point. Now, there are a couple of things that you should know about that wonderful music you just heard. First, it's by a young man named Rusty McTwire, and the band is called Zydeco Crush. And second, that young man is a friend of my next guest. Now, we're going to change the pace up here around here just a little bit with a fascinating lady that I knew way back in high school, but who is now making quite a name for herself in the world of Cajun cuisine. Pat Darbonne, also affectionately known as Pat in the Pot, was last seen on the Today Show hanging out with her new friend, Hoda. She has her own YouTube channel, Pat does, that is, not Hoda, and it's called Pat in the Pot Creole Cooking, and her website is patinthepot.com. That's Pat, the letter N, DAPOT.com, and it is a pleasure indeed to welcome her to the program. Pat, how in the world are you doing?
Oh, I'm doing great, Dave. Thank you for having me.
It's an honor. This is great. Now, I haven't seen you since the evening of the Great Flood, right?
Oh, my God, that's been a long time. God, we're telling our age.
I know. Well, I won't say what year it was, you know, but...
that's a night to remember.
Yeah,
so
that was the night of our high school graduation. Now, for those of you who weren't there, which would include pretty much all of you, we graduated from Lake Charles High School down in Louisiana, Lake Charles, Louisiana, and within an hour or two after the graduation, the heavens opened, and we had a flood of biblical proportions. Remember that?
I remember a lot of people couldn't get back home. Their car stalled, and I was one of them that almost didn't get home. My car was about to stall, but with the grace of God, I made it home.
Oh, my gosh. Yeah. Well, you survived. I didn't know what happened, but I know my dad tried to get back home the next day because he came in from Florida to see the graduation. But he couldn't get back home, so I don't know if you climbed on the ark or what.
Oh, man, that was a bad, bad rain. Bad
yeah,
blood.
Yeah. So tell me, how are things going for Pat in the pot?
Well, things are starting to take off right now faster than I can even imagine. I mean, it's just like all of a sudden I woke up one day and it just started coming in. And it's been one event after an event, and it's just overwhelming, but in a good way. So, and it all started when I went to New York last week and met Hoda on the Today Show Plaza. And she invited me to come back and do a cooking segment with her. And she had her producers come to me and get my information.
Yeah.
And I was waiting on a call from them, and I did. I got the call yesterday. The lady that does her appointments, that makes the scheduling for the cooking segments, is the one who called me.
Okay.
And, she wanted to, you know, get to know me, ask me a few questions about myself and fill me in on some stuff, and said that she'll be emailing me this Thursday with some information. So I'm looking forward to it.
How did the trip to New York City come about? How'd that all start in the first place?
Well, Dave, I'll tell you, when I want something, I want it like yesterday. I'm a very impatient person. A lot of people know that about me.
Yeah.
When I want something bad enough, I go for it. So I have been emailing the Today Show and sending videos and, you know, telling them about my story, how I want to cook on the show for Hoda. And I've been sending Hoda messages through Instagram, Facebook, tagging her on everything for the last 2 years.
Whoa.
And I haven't been getting any response. So I said, well, if I can get through to her, I'm going to go to her.
Ah.
Yes.
Okay.
So I decided that I was going to buy a plane ticket, fly up to New York.
Mm-hmm.
And go to the Today Show with my chef suit on, where she can see me, where I can stand out in the middle of the crowd. Because who goes there with a chef suit all in white? You know, I mean, you could, not only did Hoda notice, everybody out there noticed.
Yeah, you got this necklace or whatever it is of cayenne peppers around your neck or something.
Yes, that's the one I wear on all, because I cook spicy.
Yeah. Okay.
Yes. So that's my story about how I made it to New York. You know, I was determined to meet her, and my one goal is to be on the Today Show and cook for Hoda, because I want her to taste my amazing cooking.
Yeah. Well, that's how you get things done, right? You just persevere and keep at it.
I did. And, you know, those 2 years, several times I wanted to give up, but I didn't. Something just kept pushing me. God just kept saying, nope, I'm going to carry you through this. I'm going to see you through it. It's going to be, you're going to hit some bumps and along the way.
Right.
But you're going to make it.
I did.
I hit a few bumps along the way, you know, where I got discouraged. And then I just picked myself right back up and kept going.
Well, and I've been following you on Facebook, and I've been kind of living vicariously through all your adventures, but you look like you had the time of your life on that trip. They even brought you on the set.
They sure did. The security, I was the first one there that morning. I got out the cab at 4:15 in the morning, and they don't open the gates and let us in the square, the plaza, until 6:15.
No.
So the security, when I got out of the car, he looked at me. He said, boy, you serious about that? I said, yes, sir, I am. I said, am I the first one here? He said, you're the first one here. I said, that's all that matters. I said, that was my one goal, was to be first in line. I said, I told everybody in Louisiana that I was going to be first in line. I'm determined to see Hoda.
Oh, that's good. Now, I got a question. How did you get started in the whole world of Cajun cooking? How did that come about?
Well, you know, Dave, all my life I've watched my mama cook. I've always found it fascinating that she would be in the kitchen all the time, just cooking. Three meals a day. She had six of us. So she fed us breakfast, lunch, and dinner. And we didn't grow up on sandwiches. We grew up on hot meals. And every time she was at the stove cooking, it just the smell of the onions sautéing, just the smell of the meat browning, just the smell of her food got me curious. And I always pushed a chair up to the stove right next to her so I can see what was in the pot. And then when she would turn her back, I would stir the pot, you know. So I just grew up, and while all my other brothers and sisters was outside playing, I was in the house next to my mama in the kitchen. And I stayed with her in the kitchen all the time, and I watched her cook, and I watched my grandmother cook also. And I just picked up. I mean, it was just something I wanted to do. And I enjoyed watching her cooking, and I wanted to follow in her footsteps.
I'd say you did. Now, in your videos, you talk about making everything from an etouffee to jambalaya, different kinds of gravy, and something called coubillon. Now, to a lot of people, that stuff sounds really exotic and unusual and probably difficult, but it doesn't have to be exotic or difficult, right?
It's not difficult at all.
Okay.
It's not. And as a self-taught chef, I don't measure anything.
Oh.
So it's kind of hard. When I want to write a recipe for somebody, I have to kind of guess because I do not measure anything. I've never been to culinary school, not one day in my life. I don't know all those fancy dishes that they cook. I stick strictly to my heritage, which is Cajun and Creole dishes. And that's all I cook. I don't really step outside my box. And I will cook, you know, spaghetti from time to time, but I cook it in a Cajun way. I make it Cajun.
I love it. What's the difference? You mentioned Cajun and Creole cooking, and I'm guessing there's some difference between the two. What is that?
There is, Dave. Creole foods is considered a city food, and by me saying city food, back in the plantation days, the people that were more fortunate as far as money, they had access to the city markets.
Okay.
And they were able to go out and buy city foods, and Creole foods is cooked mainly with a lot of tomatoes and tomato sauce. Mm-hmm. So like they will make their jambalaya with tomatoes, whereas Cajuns will not. And a Cajun food is mostly country, because they were more like lower class, and so they grew all their vegetables and raised the chickens and the pigs and the cows and all that, and so they butchered got their own meat, and they grew all their vegetables, and they cook mostly with the Holy Trinity, which is you know, the onions, bell pepper, and celery,
right.
And they cook with a lot of spices like cayenne and paprika and all the good spices. Yes. So
go ahead. I'm sorry.
That's the difference. You know, so basically, Cajun food is country, and Creole food is city.
Yeah, it reminds me when we were talking before we started recording just a little while ago, and I mentioned my grandmother. My dad's mother, who was literally raised out on the bayou, on Bayou Lafourche, and her first language was Cajun French. So she cooked. I mean, this was the authentic, the real deal, you know, like what you're doing. And now that you mentioned it, there wasn't a lot of tomato paste and things like that. But there's a lot of paprika, a lot of the Cajun Trinity, like you said.
Right.
But it was good, too. God, I miss that.
Yes. So I cook both ways. That's why my show is called Pat in the Pot, Creole and Cajun cooking, because I cook, but I cook mostly on the Cajun side because I cook with a lot of spices and brown gravies, and I don't cook a lot of dishes that require tomatoes. You know,
etouffee
has a little tomato in it, but it's not like a Creole. Creole is all tomato, like a shrimp Creole. It's all tomatoes. Now shrimp etouffee is more of a thicker gravy and a light. Maybe pinkish color.
Mm-hmm. Now, one thing that I've noticed, because as I mentioned to you, I moved away from home long ago, and I don't get back near as often as I'd like to. Just talking to you, God, I'm homesick now. But but I do every now and then. I get brave in my travels, and I will go to some place that calls himself a Cajun restaurant. And what I oftentimes find is that they think that Cajun food is anything with enough cayenne pepper thrown in it to launch a person into outer space.
No.
You know, it's synonymous with you know, being so hot it hurts. But that's not correct, right?
No, that's not correct. We're known for our Cajun spices, and we are known for spicy food, but not like what you're talking about.
Yeah.
No.
Run around in circles with fire shooting out your butt.
And some people don't cook with the spice at all. I mean, it's to your liking and to your taste,
yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
So, I mean, on the other hand, when I'm cooking just for myself, which is hard to cook for just myself because I don't know how to cook small quantities. So
Neither did my grandmother.
Yeah, so when I cook and I have lots of food left over, I fix plate lunches and I bring them to my neighbors or bring them to my family. Or when I was working, I would bring it out to work and just give it out, pass it out to people.
Right, right.
So, no, it's not every dish is spicy.
Yeah.
Not every dish.
Yeah, it just doesn't have to hurt. I've mentioned before, not to you, but on this program and in other programs, that for the most part, I'm not really what people would call a foodie, someone who's just really obsessed with it. I look at food the way I look at a gas station. Both me and my car need fuel, you know?
Right, right, right.
But I also recognize and I do appreciate a good meal, and I also understand the cultural foundation of a lot of various types of cooking. So I guess what I'm asking is, do you see Cajun cooking as an important part of preserving and celebrating the Cajun culture that you and I both enjoyed growing up?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Yes. Cajun cooking, it's not, Louisiana is known for its Cajun cooking. I mean, myself personally, I think we have the best food in all the world.
I think you're right.
I really believe that because I have been to a lot of states. I have traveled in my younger days. I have traveled to a lot of states, and there is no place like home. The food, you step out of Louisiana, and you just don't get the seasoning like we get it here, and the flavors, you know, in the food.
Right.
A lot of people just use salt and black pepper. You know, I mean, that's no. So we have to have all our Cajun traditions here.
I tell you now, Pat, I've spent 20 years in the military. I have traveled literally all over the world, and when you say there's no other place with food like we have back home,
none.
You're exactly right.
None.
Now I notice that in your videos, you do a lot of dancing.
I love to have fun when I cook.
Yeah, and you got your drinky drink in your hand. By the way, folks, Pat's drinky drink wine tumbler is on sale now at our website, and I'll be ordering one here in a little bit, like a party glass.
Oh, awesome.
But
yes.
I see you giggling and dancing. I think one of them you're doing the twist or the boogaloo, God knows what. It's kind of hard, if not impossible, to separate Cajun cooking and Cajun culture from the whole idea of celebrating the joy of life, right?
I have it all in my blood. It's running through my veins. I'm authentic, 200% Louisiana. Everything about Louisiana runs through my veins.
And that whole
the culture, the people, the heritage, everything.
The humor.
Food, everything.
And that whole joy of life, or as they call back home, joie de vivre, that infuses your cooking too, right?
That's right. That's right. Cooking is my passion, and that's what I enjoy doing.
Oh, that's
my happy place. When I'm in my kitchen, that's my happy place.
See, I like that. I love that. Okay, last question. I know you post a lot on Facebook, and you know that I follow you on Facebook, and everyone else knows that you know that I follow you on Facebook. There was a beautiful photo that you posted from a magnificent cathedral, I guess, while you were in New York City.
That's right.
And your hands were raised, and you wrote on that post, quote, "I give God all the glory." You remember that?
I give him all the glory every day.
Well, tell me for a moment, if you will, please, about the role that your faith plays in your life and in your endeavors.
It's only God. I mean, without God, none of this would be happening. I mean, he's my light. He's my he's my everything. He's the reason I'm patting the pot. I mean, I would not be here today without God. He led me straight to New York, had me by the hand, and guided me step by step, and everything I planned happened according to plan and even better. So I had to go to the cathedral and thank him from the bottom of my heart. And I still thank him all day long, every day.
That is fantastic. I can't tell you how good it does my heart to hear that, by the way. It's just wonderful.
Now, my God in light. I can't make it without him.
You got it exactly right. Now, I know you have the website patinthepot.com, right?
Right.
Are there other places where folks can find you online if they want to learn more or watch your videos or order your Creole seasoning or anything else?
Okay, they can order my Creole seasoning on patinthepot.com, website.
Mm-hmm.
And they can follow me on, they can subscribe to my YouTube channel, Pat in the Pot Creole Cooking. And they can follow me on Instagram and Facebook. Yes, on Instagram and Facebook. And I do have a Twitter account, but I'm really not a big Twitter. I'm more Facebook than anything.
Okay.
Facebook gets everything. And then I am on Instagram, but I'm more a big fan of Facebook because it gets out there. Everybody can share.
Sure. Now, on Facebook, they just do a search for Pat in the Pot on Facebook?
Well, if they search Pat in the Pot, I have a cooking page.
Okay.
Also, I have two pages. I have a Pat in the Pot Creole and Cajun cooking page.
Yeah.
And I have Pat Darbonne, which is my personal page. And I post everything on my personal page. That's where I have all my followers.
Okay.
I don't really get a whole – I do post on my cooking page, but – all my response and likes and followers and comments are all on my personal page. They, for some reason, they just stick to my personal page instead of my cooking page.
Well, that's because you're so much fun. Okay, so it's Pat Darbonne, P-A-T-D-A-R-B-O-N-N-E, correct?
That's correct. And look, my Facebook is getting full. I think I can accept 150 more friend request. After that, I'm at the limit of 5,000.
Ooh.
Yes.
You're going to have a hell of a party at some point.
Yeah, I said that yesterday to everybody on my video. I said, somebody needs to throw a party.
Yeah.
I'm not cooking. Y'all need to cook for me.
I'll bring the drinky drinks, all right?
Yes.
All right. Pat, thank you so very much for taking the time from all the interviews and things you're doing right now to talk to the little geeky dude here from high school so long ago. I really appreciate it.
Well, I appreciate you reaching out to me, Dave, and thank you so much for having me on your show. And I look forward to hanging out with you again one day.
Yeah.
So if you're ever in town, just look me up, and I'll cook you up a good old.
I'll do it. I am so there. And let us hear what happens now. Don't be a stranger. I want to follow this and see how it goes. All right?
As soon as I know, y'all will know. That's
right.
How I am. As soon as she called me yesterday, I put it on Facebook right away. So as soon as I get the email with a time and date of when I'm going to be going, y'all will be the first to know.
Good. Pat Darbonne, thank you so much.
Thank you, Dave.
Thank you. God bless now. We'll talk to you soon.
God bless you. Okay. Bye-bye.
That's Pat Darbonne on the Dave Carter Program.
Carter on Ricochet.
Talk about being born in that bayou, baby. Of course, you don't have to be born on the bayou to pass a good time. It sure helps, though. What's that old song? It ain't what you do, but the way how you do it. Well, speaking of doing things, have you gotten around to joining All the Fun on Ricochet yet? I'll tell you what, if you haven't, what you waiting on, man? I mean, of course, you can listen to all the great offerings, podcast offerings, until your ears fall off if you want. From Law Talk with John Yoo and Richard Epstein and Troy Sinek, to former Secretary of Education Bill Bennett's program, to the flagship podcast where Rob Long, Peter Robinson, and James Lilacs engage with some of the sharpest minds and personalities out there, all the way over to this little program here. I mean, it's all here for the listening, but what if you want to do a little more than listen? I mean, just suppose for a moment that you want to comment on these podcasts and tell me to shut up and play more blues music, for example. Well, for $4.50 a month, you can do exactly that and a lot more. You see, $4.50 gets you access to all the posts on the main feed and on the members-only feed. And you'll be able to comment on all of those posts and engage with the authors, whether it's Peter Robinson himself or any other distinguished pundit or the great members we have. You can talk to them directly and engage them in conversation in the comments. I mean, how great is that? And check this out. For just 50 cents more per month, $5 a month, you can write your own post and your own columns, if you like, and see them published on one of the most influential and widely read sites in the country. And you'll spend more than that just sending a bunch of letters to reach important people that may or may not ever read you, or even let alone respond to you, but they read Ricochet. You can take the money you save and do something else with it, you know, like, I don't know, leave. Go to the beach. Get them Rugrats to the babysitter and go take some place and relax. And take Ricochet with you. Now, I'm getting a little carried away, but why not? I mean, trust me, Ricochet is the home of the most civil and interesting conversations on the web today. And you'll be doing yourself and the rest of us a favor by participating in the proceedings. Just go to ricochet.com/join to learn more. Again, that's ricochet.com/join and join the conversation.
One, two, three.
Yes, it's time to get mom and dad and the kids and grandkids and the aunts and the uncles and the nieces and the nephews all gathered around the radio for the Dave Carter Show. Too bad it's not coming out of the radio.
Thank you, James Lilacs. Hey, we're having a good time here today with my friend Joel Valdez in the studio, and that was a good conversation with Pat, wasn't it?
It was.
She's
energetic.
Yeah, she is. It's just contagious.
Yeah.
I don't mean like it's not contagious like when you listen to her, you have to sneeze. But I mean, she's really, you know, just kind of catches.
That's Pat Prequel,
right? Right. Yeah. You ever do any cooking?
Yes.
Yeah.
I taught myself to cook about a year ago.
Oh, okay. Tell me more. What kind of cooking do you like to do here?
I like to do a lot of Italian recipes. So I taught myself
how to
make...
You do a little Cajun twist?
No. I have before, but not usually. Yeah, okay. Like I taught myself how to make pizza from scratch, pasta from scratch, and a lot of recipes like that. I've baked before. I know your wife does a lot of baking.
Yeah.
I have a picture of the one cake I ever made from scratch, and then from then on I've been box.
Why?
Because it's hard.
Time? Oh, it's okay. I've never tried that.
It's all right. Don't do it.
When I was my kids and I years ago, when it was just the three of us at the house for a while, we'd do one of those box pizzas. And I thought I was really accomplishing something, right? I'm not even sure I could do that now. I tried years later when they were adults, and we were at my son's place. Anyway, we were the three of us said, let's do a pizza again, like we did years ago.
Yeah.
I had no idea what to do. So they helped me, you know. Basically kind of took over.
Mm.
I can do red beans and rice.
Mm.
And I do the Cajun Trinity that Pat was talking about, you know.
Peppers, onion.
Bell pepper, onion, and celery.
Yeah.
And white pepper, Tabasco sauce. And in the red beans and rice, I put a little bit of brown sugar.
Mm.
And it takes some of that initial bite out of the spice. And it's also kind of like a delayed fuse. You know, it's kind of sweet at first, and then, oh, that's where the heat went.
Yeah.
Kind of comes up. But I'm not interested in having people, you know, feel like they just put gunpowder in their mouth and put a match to it. So I don't do that. But that's about the only thing. I mean, Shelley and her mom do trust me each morning to go in the kitchen and heat up English muffins.
But that's
for me, not for them. Yeah. For me. And I can make a mean peanut butter and jelly sandwich. That's about the extent of it.
Oh, wow.
But I'm surrounded by culinary experts here.
Yeah, that's
so
true.
So I defer to them, and I will not submit my work for their critique. So, but they do great. I don't need to see her mom. Oh, my gosh. They all can cook.
Mm.
So, have you ever been to New Orleans?
No, never.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, you got to go.
I'm from higher up, so I've never been that low.
Oh, I'm sorry. If you ever decide to lower yourself to
No.
I know. Man, talking about good food. Oh, my gosh. I can give you a list of places to go.
Yeah, I would love to go down there.
It's good. And you can go to Café du Monde, which is where – you're familiar with beignets?
Yeah.
Okay. That's where they serve – Café du Monde's been there for 100-something years now.
Oh, wow.
And they do beignets and the café au lait, which is coffee and chicory with a whole lot of cream.
Mm-hmm.
It is so good. When my dad was little, he called them Band-Aids.
Band-Aids?
Instead of beignets. Oh. Little kid. But, man, there's so much to see there, you know? Go check out the cemeteries because they're all above ground.
Yeah.
Because of the water table, they'll wash up on shore.
Oh, wow.
So there's like cities, basically, these cemeteries. Go on a tour group. It's the only way that it's safe. But there's just so much to see there, man. Jack's Brewery, which is across the street from the cathedral there. We should go in the cathedral. I'll tell him myself. I used to go in the cathedral almost every time when I was single to ask forgiveness preemptively.
Before you went into
right.
Jack's Brewery?
Yeah. But anyway, but oh gosh, the brewery, my grandfather used to deliver beer out of that brewery to Southwest Louisiana, which is where he met my grandmother. And there we are. So he drove a truck and then I drove a truck. It's kind of interesting. But man, if you ever get a chance to go there.
Yeah, I would love to.
It is so cool.
I'm all into that spice and stuff like that, so I would love to sample the local cuisine.
Go to Pat O'Brien's on Bourbon Street for the red beans and rice. I took Shelley and her mom there. They walked a little funny afterwards because that's also the home of the hurricane drink.
Okay, yeah.
They kind of went zigzagging, you know. But, of course, they attributed that to the cobblestones, and it's kind of uneven terrain to navigate. You know? But it's good food. And then you can go to, the cathedral. Are you interested in the paranormal?
Always.
Well, we're friends, so obviously, you know, abnormal at least.
Yeah.
But one of the hotels I stayed at, Le Pavillon, is one of the most haunted places in the city.
Really?
Yeah.
Haunted how?
It's been there since the 1800s.
Oh.
And so an awful lot of things have happened there. And there's a painting. The restaurant there, they call it the Crystal Room.
Mm-hmm.
And it's got these huge chandeliers. I mean, the size of like a Prius. Hanging from the really from the
not that big.
The Czechoslovakian, okay, right. Well, maybe a gas guzzler. Mm. But they're hanging from, you know, and they're Czechoslovakian crystal. Above the fireplace in this this is a great restaurant. Classical music is playing, you know, and it's just very, very, very relaxing. There's a painting of a beautiful young lady, red hair. And this, from what the story that the bartender there told me is that people have seen her.
Mm.
Evidently, when the place started, she was one of the frequent locals that went there, visited there, and she was killed. From what I understand, horses started or whatever, and it rolled over her.
Oh, wow.
And the family donated her painting, you know, to the place. And people have said that, there's this unusual-looking red-haired lady that I saw up on the rooftop where the pool is. One guy in his picture said that to the bartender. And then he was called. His reservation was ready, and so he went into the restaurant and promptly freaked out, and came back and said, "That's her." He's pointing at the lady, the painting. That was the lady that I saw.
Oh, wow.
It's really interesting stuff. So
that is
it's a fun place.
I would go once.
Yeah. Well, then you'd want to go back. Well, I don't know. Everybody has a place. I don't know where that is for you, but you know where they feel right.
Yeah.
You know, you look around and say, yeah, this is where I belong. This is home, right? For me, that's New Orleans.
Modernly, it's Memphis for me.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Well, then you may not want to get out of here, right?
I mean, I'm never not open to going to, especially a place like that with so much history and so much culture.
You'll like it. And what we did, by the way, is we took the Amtrak, City of New Orleans, train down there. Because no sense in driving, because you're going to park your car and your car's going to have to pay for all the to be able to park at these places.
Yeah.
And you will pay a hefty amount for your car to stay here. Notwithstanding that your car doesn't get turned down service for it's bad at night or anything, but you're going to be billed like it had. So why not take that money, less than it would cost, get cabs to go around town, take the train down there, and then use cabs, is what we did. Very, very easy.
Hmm.
We'll talk more. No, I'll have my people call your people. Yeah, they can arrange to go down there, have some red beans and rice, and we'll get Pat down there and she can
see
cook,
the lady.
Cook. Yeah, there you go. The red haired lady that scares the hell out of people. Be great. All right. I'm thoroughly homesick now. I'm ready to go. Get out of this
place.
We'll
get your little Uncle Ben.
Go to the bayou for a while. Look, man, it's been great having you on here.
It's been great to be back on, man. Thanks for having me.
This is fun. I really appreciate it. Thanks for taking the time to chat with us.
It's no problem.
And my thanks also to Pat Darbonne, whose rise to fame we will be watching and cheering, and the General Hatchet and Alphonse, the usual suspects, all that stuff. So, and that's that. Joel, thanks again, bro.
No problem, man.
Get out.
Time.
No, I'm just kidding. And as always, with my special thanks to you, the listener, I am Dave Carter for Ricochet.com.
But the only thing that keeps me sane is driving down the bayou in the pouring rain. Yo, I've been gone too long.